Hi all, welcome to Smart Catalyst, 20th December 2018. Today we'll be discussing 8 topics related to prelims. The first one is related with GSAT 7A, the second one related with the gender pay gap report issued by World Economic Forum, the third one related with surrogacy regulation bill being introduced in Rajya Sabha. The fourth one is about the places in news, about the recent truce talk between Houthi rebels and Yemeni government. Fifth one is about Niti Aayog's strategy for India at 75. The sixth one is the year-end review of Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation. Seventh one is about the reusable rocket technology being mulled by the ISRO. The last one is about four banks which are expected to be out of the PCA framework of RBI. Let's move to the first article. The first article is related with the launch of GSAT 7A by ISRO. Satellite communication is too important for a country. And apart from civilian uses, it has also got some usages in defense mechanism. For them, among the defense units, Air Force needs more satellite communication. In order to meet the demands of Indian Air Force, ISRO has launched GSAT 7A. The GSAT 7A has also been termed as Angry Bird of India. And as I mentioned earlier, it is meant for exclusive use of Indian Air Force. And the main purpose of GSAT 7A is to enhance the communication infrastructure of Indian Air Force. This is the basic about GSAT 7A. And there has been question about the launch vehicles of ISRO. And the GSAT 7A was launched by the launch vehicle GSLV F-11. The GSLV F-11 is the 7th flight of GSLV Mark 3. Technology, and the rocket is also deployed with cryogenic engine mechanism. This GSLV F-11 would launch the GSAT 7A into the geosynchronous transfer orbit. One important point to note is that the GSLV F-11 also uses Indian cryogenic engine. Earlier, we used to use the technology of Russians in cryogenic engine, but this GSLV F-11 has marked the indigenous testing of India's cryogenic technology. This GSAT 7A would help the Indian Air Force to interlink different ground radar stations in order to analyze the movement of aircrafts. And it links the different air bases of India. We have different air bases among different parts of India, and this satellite would help in linking the different air bases of India. Also, it would play a major role in improving the potential of airborne warning and control systems. Apart from supporting the network communications of Indian Air Force, GSAT 7A has also got capacity to support the network communications of Indian Navy. And this would also play a crucial role in improving the effectiveness of drones operations. In addition to GSAT 7A, the Indian Air Force is also expected to receive the services of another satellite, GSAT 7C, in few years down the line in order to enhance the already existing network capacity created by GSAT 7A. Let's move to the next article. This article is about the existing prevalent gender pay gap among the different countries of the world. The report has been released by World Economic Forum. They have analyzed around 149 countries, and of them India has been ranked 108th. The major theme line of the report is that it will take another 202 years for countries to bridge the gap between genders as far as their pay is concerned with. One irony of this report is Iceland and other Nordic countries, who have been at the top of the table as far as gender gap is concerned, has got wide pay gap. For example, consider the case of Iceland. Iceland is the most equal country in terms of political roles, but as far as the pay gap is concerned, there is still a 33% age gap. Whereas a developing country like Laos in Southeast Asia is very close to achieving parity. The women pay is close to achieving parity with the men's pay, and the gap is only 9%. The conflict-driven countries like Yemen, Syria and Iraq, they have highest pay gaps. Women being paid equally as men will create more employment opportunities in domestic services sector like housekeeping, cooking, caretaking and all. Apart from creating new employment opportunities, it also creates equity among gender. The countries must take initiatives in order to bring in equity among genders. The next article is about passing of Surrogacy Regulation Bill 2016 in Parliament. what necessitated the framing of new legislation for regulating surrogacy. India was considered to be the surrogacy capital of the world. The lack of agency among Indian women belonging to socially vulnerable class, socially and economically vulnerable class, pushed them towards renting their home to gain money. And because of this, various illegal activities were happening in the country. In order to regulate, in order to curb those illegal activities, the government has passed this Surrogacy Regulation Bill 2016. So what are the basic features of the Surrogacy Regulation Bill 2016? One of the main features is that the bill recommends for altruistic surrogacy, no commercial surrogacy. Commercial surrogacy is where people look for rented wombs, whereas altruistic surrogacy is done in the good intent. The bill also mandates that only a close relative of a woman can act as a surrogate mother. Also, the couple who are opting for surrogacy should have been infertile and they would have been married for 5 years minimum in order to opt for surrogacy option. Since it is altruistic surrogacy, the method mentioned in this act doesn't involve any payment to the surrogate mother. This bill will also help in curbing the menace of fashion surrogacy. The next article is about places in news. Ceasefire between Yemen's Houthi rebels and the Yemeni government was signed in December 18. This process was termed as Stockholm Peace Agreement. Normally, UPSC has a practice of picking up important places in news and asking a question based on that. It may be either in master following form or it may be in select the right statement form. So it is pertinent for us to know about the different places that has come in news. Before going into the geography of the region, we have to know what is the background of the problem. From 2015, there has been growing conflict between the Houthi rebels and the Yemen government. The Houthi rebels are supported by Iran and other Shia countries. Yemen is supported by Saudi Arabia. At one particular point during the year 2016, the Houthi rebels control the maximum territory. But with the support of Saudi Arabia and US in the backdoor, Yemeni government reclaimed the territories, and only a few important areas like Houthi port was left with the Houthi rebellions. The Houthi port is located somewhere here along the Red Sea. There has been going peace talks between both the parties for the past few years. But now the process has been hastened because of Saudi Arabia's waning public image. Following the assassination of journalist Ismail Khashoggi. Owing to the pressure exerted upon Saudi Arabia by the international players who were opting for global peace, Saudi Arabia had asked the Yemen government to go for a truce between the Houthi rebellions. Also, the country Yemen has been listed last among the global peace index due to the internal strife. Also, the socio-economic conditions has pushed more health problems to prevail in the Yemen. In order to curtail all these menace to the human capital and human welfare, the parties have signed an agreement known as Stockholm Peace Agreement. Now let's go into the geography of the region. Yemen is located between Arabian Sea and Red Sea. The capital of Yemen is Sana'a. Yemen is surrounded by Saudi Arabia and Oman. It is separated from Djibouti and Somalia by Gulf of Aden. It is located along the important route that connects the Asian mainland with the Suez Canal. And we saw earlier that the Houthi port is located along this Red Sea, so it becomes more important and strategic location along the white ship traffic of the world. Let's move to the next article. This article is about Niti Aayog's strategy for creating New India by 2022. 2022 marks 75 years of India as an independent country. So Niti Aayog has been framing many strategies in order to be a developed and well-grown economy by 2022. Let's see these strategies one by one. The foremost aim of Niti Aayog is to make India a $4 trillion economy by 2022, and this is a step towards making India a $5 trillion economy by 2030. Investment formation is one of the important fuel for driving the engines of economy. So the strategy aims at increasing the gross fixed capital formation to the 36% from the present 29% by 2022. Economic well-being of primary sector is more important and more crucial in the economic well-being of a country. So agriculture has to be given more focus. Instead of considering them to be growers of crops, they should be trained in order to become agripreneurs. Agripreneurs is a term which is created by joining agriculture and entrepreneurship. The farmers, instead of being sellers of food crops, they should become food-based entrepreneurs. Necessary amendments and necessary changes has to be introduced in Agricultural Produce Marketing Committee Act and also in the functioning of APMCs. Considering the harm created by chemical pesticides and increasing input cost of farmers, which is hampering their profit, zero input methods like zero budget natural farming should be introduced. Mineral wealth of India should be explored in a more positive manner. For that, schemes, missions based to explore in India has to be introduced, thereby opening Indian mining, Indian minerals to the foreign companies to explore, and this would create more employment opportunities for India. One important pillar for a country's growth is economy. The economy is the soul and infrastructure is the body. A soul cannot survive without a body. So physical foundations of growth, that is infrastructure, has to be focused on. There has been a proposal to introduce Rail Development Authority, and a body to focus on improving the quality of railways in India, taking important decision pertaining to railways in India. This mechanism, the establishment of Rail Development Authority, has to be expedited in a faster manner. Using BharatNet program, the government is been aiming to provide broadband services to different parts of the country at panchayat level. By 2022-23, the scheme would be achieving its aim. This would digitally connect different parts of the country. Convergence is no way to success for a developing economy, for a developing country like India. Inclusive development is a key to achieve New India by 2022. For that, government should focus on including the marginalized section in health education sectors. Economy is soul of a country. Infrastructure is body of the country and governance is brain of the country. All three has to act in sync in order to create a proper functioning nation. So governance should be focused on. The recommendations of second ARC commission has to be implemented thoroughly. And the major problem in India is about delay in jurisprudence. So new autonomous body, Arbitration Council of India, has to be set up in order to grade the arbitral practices in the country, which would create space for cost-effective and speedy justice in India. So these are the strategies discussed by the Niti Aayog in order to create a new India by 2022. The next article is about the year-end review published by Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation. Drinking water and sanitation has been playing a crucial role in improving health of the citizens of India. The ministry has launched many schemes in order to improve the sanitation and the quality of drinking water in India. One of the prominent scheme introduced by the government of India is Swachh Bharat Mission. The scheme aims at making India open defecation free by 2019. The annals of independent India's history has been marked with many measures taken by the governments to introduce healthy toilet practices. But these were all disturbed by the negative behavioral aspects existing in Indian society. In order to answer the negative behavioral aspects, the Swachh Bharat Mission has identified behavioral change as an important tool to make India open defecation free. Apart from this Swachh Bharat Mission, the ministry has also launched many schemes like Namami Gange. Namami Gange is to celebrate the river Ganga, which is considered to be holy by many of the Indian Hindus. And the main aim of Namami Gange is to make the villages along river Ganga open defecation free. and creating technological interventions which would make technological interventions to provide solid and liquid waste management. The next is about a Swachhata Action Plan. This is done to ensure annual planning and implementation of sanitation related activities. Also, in the budget 2018, the government announced a scheme called Gobardhan scheme, through which the village sanitation was focused on. This has two important aims: one, to improve the income of farmers and cattle owners, and two, that's the first aim, and the second aim is to improve the sanitation and hygiene in the villages. This scheme aims at promoting local entrepreneurs to convert cattle dung and other organic resources to biogas and organic manure. Next is Swajal program. Swajal program is a community demand driven program in 117 districts identified by the Niti Aayog. The functioning of the scheme involves installing solar powered pumps to provide potable water system in different parts of the 117 identified villages. The next article is about reusable rocket technology being pondered upon by ISRO. We saw in the first article that the GSLV F11 has been used for 7th launch this year. Every launch of a satellite launch vehicle involves around $60 million. The huge cost involved in the process makes the space exploration a costly affair. So, in order to reduce the cost of access to space, ISRO has been working on a new technology called as reusable rocket technology. This is new to India. Many private entrepreneurs like SpaceX, they have tried this reusable rocket technology. What happens when a satellite launch vehicle is launched? First, it takes off from the destined location. The first stage separation happens when it reaches a certain altitude, and after, the other motors, other fuel sources attached to the launch vehicle, it gets geared up and it reaches a particular altitude where the second stage gets separated and the satellite is launched into the lower entry orbit. Then the satellite launching part is separated, it comes down through parachute deployment, and it is collected from a ocean. This process has been proposed to be introduced in reusable rocket technology. In order to understand the concept behind this, we have to go through a bit of elementary physics. There is a particular concept called aerodynamics. Aerodynamics regulates the speed and direction of a fast-moving object. Just imagine this: a satellite launch vehicle, which is of huge size and huge weight, it's falling down from the space and it has to be directed in a proper manner. And this cannot be done manually, and it has to be guided by the aerodynamic designing of the launch vehicle. So first, they have been planning to develop a winged body unmanned reusable launch vehicle. Then, due to the friction created by the falling object, the satellite launch vehicle would experience high thermal stress and high temperature, and this too increases the pressure in the system. So ISRO is working on an autonomous navigation, guidance, control and reusable thermal protection system, and this has been successfully demonstrated. This thermal protection system, the successful launch of thermal protection system and lower earth orbit entry system, the ISRO has even developed a technology demonstration vehicle, which has indicated that the proposals and the technology introduced by ISRO would be successful in real time. This is the basic of reusable rocket technology being worked upon by the ISRO. The next article is about the proposed relaxation of restrictions upon four banks. Under the prompt corrective action framework of RBI, 12 scheduled commercial banks have been placed. Of them, 11 are public sector banks. We all know what a prompt corrective action framework is. We have elaborately discussed the different aspects of prompt corrective action framework in our previous videos. Let's have a brief recap of Prompt Corrective Action Framework. Prompt Corrective Action Framework is an initiative, is a corrective measure introduced by RBI in order to save the loss-making banks. The criteria for prompt corrective actions are based on profitability, asset quality, and capital adequacy. As we saw earlier, around 11 public sector banks are placed under this prompt corrective action framework. Of them, recently, it has been reported that Bank of Maharashtra, Corporation Bank, Allahabad Bank and Bank of India may come out of the strong regulatory framework of prompt corrective action. The prompt corrective action, being under prompt corrective action, these banks will have restriction on their branch expansion. Expansion of credit portfolio and expansion of deposit portfolio. So, placing a bank under the prompt corrective action framework completely restricts the day-to-day operations of a bank. The government has been suggesting, recommending RBI to ease off those PCA norms, and this was one of the main irritants for conflict between RBI and central government. Now, in order to help these four banks to come out of the prompt corrective action framework, RBI may provide relaxations to the threshold limits set under prompt corrective action framework. If at all there is any shortfall for banks in capital adequacy, the government may infuse regulatory capital in order to support the functioning of those banks. Thank you.